Valentine's Day. Should make everybody smile. Right, Jack?
I'm with you, Commissioner.
Before we begin today, I want to share just one piece of information. We lost a gentleman this week who I consider to be one of the pillars of our community. Mr. John Joy was Carroll County Commissioner from 1974 to 1978. And I think those of us, I know, Dick, you remember Mr. Joy, Commissioner Joy. He served well, and always like to remember those that have served in this position prior to us, because as we all know, this is a difficult job. And those guys back in the 70s set some precedents here for Carroll moving forward. So I want to reach out to his family and give our condolences from Carroll County, and recognize Commissioner Joy this morning. We're going to rise for the pledge, and then I would ask, if you so desire, to remain standing as we will honor all those in the military and those in public safety with a moment of silence, and anyone that you would like to remember in this moment of self-reflection.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. Okay, before we get to your thing, Commissioner Lieber, we'd like to, if any of my colleagues have anything for priority, Carroll, this is the first week that we have changed that, and we had talked about this a little bit, and certainly it's still positively Carroll. But there are a lot of things that we do here in our everyday jobs, and all of us have the number one priority on our minds, and that's this fantastic county that we live in. So positively Carroll has now become priority Carroll. My colleagues.
I'll start out at a gate. Saturday night I attended the 70th anniversary awards banquet for the New Windsor Volunteer Fire Department. What a wonderful experience that was. New Windsor, along with Union Bridge, are a priority of mine to help them with economic development, and it's so nice to see such a God-fearing, loving community that comes together and volunteers for the well-being of their fellow citizens. So a big shout-out to New Windsor, and thank you very much.
Well, I think four of us attended the annual dinner meeting for the Agricultural Center. On the Tuesday night, I believe. Mm-hmm. So, very interesting meeting. I think one of the highlights, Brian Butler, our county extension agent, definitely gave a little idea on where agriculture is in the county. And I think I was really impressed with the number of support jobs that are needed. Even though our production has gone up, the people involved in the production have gone down, but the total number of support jobs and things has gone up tremendously, and that, if you got nothing else out of that, I think that set the tone of where agriculture is in the future in Carroll County, and all the issues that come into it, whether it's nutrient management, IT, extension, all the regulatory groups, and the amount of people needed to have that type of support for food production is tremendous.
Yeah, some of the numbers were very eye-opening.
Yeah.
For instance, the dairy farms where they, even through the decades, and how many there are not any longer. That, you know, how we started and where we are today. So, yep, very, very good.
Again, a happy Valentine's Day. And when I started, I began very quickly to recognize the value of our government staff and the folks my left and right, and those that work for us to make our government run so well. This past week, I received a testament to that. I just want to read you this, and I did share it with those involved from our government and also with our CAO. But it's a real, again, testament to the value and professionalism of our staff and the things they do. So this came from a gentleman in regards to Carroll County Public Works, had to reach out for a main sewer line blockage, received a call from the supervisor within 10 minutes of contacting the department. He shared with me the team would be at my home within 15 minutes to assess our issues and address the problem. Absolutely phenomenal service and speedy service for a public service is a pleasure to experience, and I want those involved to be recognized. Thank you to Kelly, Brett, Nick, and Al. Don't want to forget the young lady whom took the call, but I didn't catch her name. Even in nasty weather, bad roads, and cold temps, all involved were happy to help, and we appreciate it. Please be sure to recognize these hardworking servants, which I did privately, but I really do believe in recognizing folks publicly for great work that they do. So, again, a Bravo Zulu or a shout out to them.
So.
Good.
I'm surprised it has been mentioned already, but Carroll 101 got kicked off last night. We were all there. We had questions and answers from people in the audience about how Carroll County government runs, and I thought it went very, very well. There's a large number of people over there, and there's how many more?
Four
more scheduled. And if you want information on it, you want information on the government, it's a good thing to, you know, contact the county. We'll give you information on when the next ones are. I thought it was very, very well done last night.
So if I may.
That introduction was a little long, but other than that,
wait, what?
So if I may add to your shameless plug. So Carroll 101 is an opportunity for citizens in the county to learn more about county government and what we do on a day-to-day basis. You'll hear presentations from all of the leaders of county government, so all the directors, along with a representative from your courts, the chief administrative judge or one of the others, the sheriff's office, and the state's attorney's office. Along with the health department, will also be presenting. The county attorney is one of the call directors. He's not giving the statement. He'll be presenting as well. So last night, as you said, was our kickoff. We got very good feedback from the folks in attendance. I've also seen it on social media. It was very positive. So I thank you, gentlemen, for your time last night. To talk with the citizens and also the rest of the staff and others who are participating in it. And there is still time to register. You can go to the Carroll Community College website. They're handling our registration. So it's every Wednesday from now through the middle of March. So thank you.
Yep. Very well. Went very well last night. Two quick things. We'd like to thank the members of the Arts Guild, for providing art for our lobby in the commissioner's office. And when you are in the building, make sure you kind of be aware of your surroundings, because not only are they in our lobby, they've also provided art on the first floor of the county office building. So some great art from a lot of local artists that is on display throughout this building. So take a look around as you're walking through, and we want to thank them, and we are glad to provide an opportunity for them to display their art in a building that gets a lot of visitors. So more to come on that. And they switch those out like every month or so. So
About every couple of months, 3 months.
Okay. So there's that. And also on behalf of my colleagues, and all of us do this every day, and kind of along the theme of Commissioner Rothstein, we had some interesting weather again last week. And our folks were right out doing what they always do. And our roads were in great shape. All of our facilities, you could get to them pretty easily. We had the delay opening. That was for Commissioner Frazier, so he could wake up that day. But we see how that was a see that return shot that I did there. But we appreciate all the work that our folks do when everybody else is sleeping. So they continue to do a great job. So kudos to them, Commissioner Weaver.
Well, I have a great opportunity today to do a proclamation for National FFA Week. And if you look in our audience, there are quite a few young and some older ones out there wearing blue and gold. But appreciate you guys coming in today. But I just wanted to take mention, you know, looking back, we have some people that in the county here who grew up through the FFA. And Miss Tammy Black, who works with
Access Carroll.
Access Carroll. I was going to say ARC. Yeah, Access Carroll.
I'm here for you.
Yeah, thank you. Was a strong FFA member in her day. Doug Reitz, who's the police chief at Mount Airy now, had a long career with the state police and chief of Mount Airy Police. Remember him sitting in FFA class. Those guys have a strong back. Diana Jones, our staff. Diana, stand up, please. Ag specialist here. She has her FFA jacket hung on the wall in that area. So they all have a strong background, and but basically where you guys are now in their younger years, as well as you know, Joe Linthicum has spent a career with FFA. Aaron Guyman, who was a former student, actually. I won't go any further, but he has done a lot with the thing. Shelby, I appreciate what you've done with FFA. Here again, her parents were students, and Diane Safar in the back of the Winners Mill have done a tremendous job of promoting and bringing the youth along. So I want to read our proclamation and come up front then for a picture with these members. Whereas FFA and agriculture education provide a strong foundation for the youth of America in the future of food, fiber, and natural resource systems, and where FFA promotes premier leadership, personal growth, and career success among its members, and where if the FFA and agriculture education ensure a steady supply of young professionals to meet the growing demands of science, business, and technology of agriculture, and whereas the FFA motto, learning to do, doing to learn, earning to live, living to serve, give direction of purpose to these students who take an active role in succeeding in agricultural education. And whereas career and technical education offers individuals lifetime opportunities to learn new skills which provide them with career choices and potential life satisfaction. And whereas FFA promotes citizenship, volunteerism, patriotism, and cooperation. Now, therefore, we the commissioners of Carroll County do hereby proclaim February 16th to 23rd as FFA Week in Carroll County, invite all citizens to take due note of this observance, signed by all five commissioners. I just want to mention the careers out there that are ag-related that take some knowledge of agriculture is unbelievable. I hear constantly the people who are being hired with similar majors, they don't have the background, or production background. They really don't have the knowledge. They try to fit them into the jobs, but I think there are 35,000 open jobs right now in the country that would love to have somebody with an agricultural background in it. So if we could get everybody to come down in front here for a picture.
You want to have, I don't know, if Aaron, you want to introduce who's here today maybe first?
Yeah.
Why don't we do that first? Because I'd like to get our young people introduced, and then we'll do the photo.
I'll let each of them come introduce themselves.
That's fine. Yep. You? Yep.
Hello, I'm Aaron Guyman, the agriculture educator at Westminster High School and FFA advisor. Start with the Winners Mill students, the Manchester Valley students, the Westminster students, and the Francis Scott Key students and advisor.
Kyle's himself here.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Sorry about that.
My name is Kyle Schultz, and I'm a senior at South Carolina High School, and I'm president of our FFA chapter.
Kyle, if you can start over here. Why don't you come over here, and then as everybody introduces, we'll get everybody up front then. Just start over here. Okay.
Hello, I'm Nicole Doublevis. I'm from the Winners Mill FFA chapter. I'm a senior at Winners Mill, and I am the chapter president.
I'm Crystal Stowers. I'm a senior at Manchester Valley High School, and I'm currently the FFA president for our chapter.
I'm Avery Dolph from Westminster High School. I'm a junior, and I'm our chapter's vice president.
I'm Abby Wimmer from Westminster High School. I'm currently a sophomore, and I am our secretary.
I'm Sierra Lee. I'm from the Francis Scott Key chapter, and I am a senior.
I'm Allison Snyder. I'm from Francis Scott Key. I am a junior and currently the secretary.
Very good.
And I am Faye Farr, and I'm the advisor from Winters Mill High School.
Hi, Bridget Nicholson, advisor at Manchester Valley High School.
Shelby Althoff, I'm the advisor at Francis Scott Key High School.
And I'm Joe Linthick. I'm representing the alumni for our region, which includes Carroll, Baltimore, and Hartford County. And just a point of note, this year at the National Convention, we'll be celebrating the 50th anniversary of admitting young ladies into the FFA organization.
Excellent. Yeah, that's good. Okay, want to do a photo op here, advisors?
Those with your visitors pass up here and take them down because the camera glare will.
Yeah, a couple of stuff here. Would that help?
That'd be cool.
Yeah.
Nice to meet you. Oh, good. Thank you very much. I need to give that community some more love.
Thank you guys. Thank you guys very much. Hey, Aaron, what was the fuzzy thing again? I'm sorry, the reference to the fuzzy thing. I just want to make
Some
sure I got.
Some of us affectionately called Mr. Weaver Big Chief Fuzzy Face.
Oh, okay.
And then he got elected. And now he's nice and clean shaven. He looks more handsome.
I'm glad you're trying to keep up.
More handsome.
Thank you guys very much. Thank you.
Fuzzy Face? Okay. I got it.
Wow. All right. Mr. Fowler is number one on the agenda this morning. He frantically came up the road from Annapolis this morning, or maybe in between. So, for those that don't know, Mike is our legislative liaison, and there are a lot of things, and I will refrain from labeling them good or bad, happening in Annapolis right now. We're in the heat of the activity down there. So Mike is going to share with us some of the things that are going on. So Mike, good morning.
And if I could just make a remark about the young people, that was pretty amazing. I was flipping through, going back to look at some hearings, and there was one on pesticides, and there was an agronomist, a golf course superintendent, testifying, and he was talking about how he applies this pesticide and the computerized technology he uses, and it just the world that they're the world of farming that they're coming into is markedly different, I'm sure, than it was just a few years ago. So it's great to see young people engaged like that.
Yeah,
anyway.
Good stuff.
So, yes, there's a lot happening in Annapolis. With only 54 days remaining until sine die, actually, the number of bills are down this year by about 1,000, But the problems they had early on in getting them through DLS and issued has, you know, created a backlog. So they weren't able to use that early period to move some of these bills through as they normally would. So last week was, I guess Monday a week ago, was the final day for submittal in the Senate, and Friday was the last day in the House. And there was an avalanche of bills in each chamber on, you know, the days coming up. Something like 600-800 in the House just in those 3 days, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday of last week. So a lot of bills to be heard, and the hearing lists are going to continue to grow each day. Of course, the Legislative Committee has been meeting. We missed the first meeting because of that delay. There really wasn't anything to talk about, and I think we had some weather issues, too. So we've had two Legislative Committee meetings at MACO. So let me just give you real quickly your agenda bills. It was a modest agenda. The bond bill has been heard in both chambers, as you might expect. No issues there. The Sunday gaming, Sunday repeal for gaming was heard in Budget and Tax in the Senate, and next week we've got it in Ways and Means, and again, no questions there. I should say both of those bills, Sunday prohibition and also the pull tab machines for the fraternal lodges were heard as well. Yesterday was a hearing in the Senate committee for the statewide bill for those fraternal lodges. And the word that I'm getting is that the president of the Senate really doesn't like to see these types of bills come through because, however small they may be, they're concerned about a threat to the casino revenues and subsequently to education. So many of those are a challenge to get through. I'm hopeful that our small bill to help our fire departments on Sundays won't get caught up in that overall philosophy. So the big issues to date have been, of course, the minimum wage bill, the fight for 15. That was heard in Economic Matters in the House side last week. It's scheduled for Finance Committee in the Senate for next week. You know, the fiscal analysis, and I've pulled it directly out of there, there used to be a number of carve-outs in there, and many of those are getting wiped away. So the groups that are no longer exempted are commission employees, employees that are, well, seasonal workers. So you think about it on the Eastern Shore, the crab houses and such, and then certain farm workers as well. So the minimum wages are set. That bill will be July 1st, assuming it passes, which I'm certain it will. $11 per hour in 19, and then it goes up by $1 per year to the maximum of 15 in 2023. The direct impact to the county from that is probably minimal, but I think the major concerns are not really addressed in the bill, and that's the upward wage pressure created. And that's going to be across the board, not only the counties, but in the private sector as well. Of course, MACO is not weighing in on this. They're not taking a position on this bill. These are the types of bills they believe that the counties really don't move the needle on, and so they want to sort of hold their political capital, if you will. So that leaves the counties free to address it in the way they see fit. Now, none of the counties really addressed it on the House side, but as you heard on the Rural County Coalition call, some of the rural counties are very concerned about this and trying to compile some data, and I believe Kim Frock is also working on that. I think Washington County has sort of taken the lead and created a template for developing that data, and we're waiting for them to share that template with us so we can put that together as well and then let those counties get together and get their heads together and see how they want to move forward on this.
Yeah, I reminded Corey yesterday from Washington to make sure they get that template to us. And I don't want to steal your thunder on that, but just to a little bit extra, you know, they're concerned up there because they've got a lot of businesses that can easily go to Pennsylvania or West Virginia, and we're sort of in the same boat. You know, these small businesses, they can't afford to get that to the level of that minimum wage, and many business owners have in the areas where they can move easily have said, "See you, Maryland." So it's a problem.
Yeah, I believe it's have an extremely negative impact upon our local economy. And whatever gain these individuals think they're going to make at the 15-hour minimum wage, they're going to lose with the cost of living. Because naturally, as a businessman, I know what's going to happen. The cost of everything is going to go up. So whatever initial gain they think they're going to get, they're going to lose. And it all settle right back into the same economic level they were prior to going into it. And we as a state, being a small state, and I recognize the challenges Washington County has, especially if 81 cutting through them, being so close to neighboring counties, we're going to lose business. So I think there's going to be a severe long-term economic, negative economic impact upon the state overall if we do this, or the state does this.
And one of the arguments that the proponents of this make is when you pay employees more, that money comes back into the economy. So that's what you'll hear from the proponents. Along the lines of that,
by the way, I got the template, Mike.
Did you?
Yeah.
So. See, they heard us.
They're tuned in.
Yeah, they're evidently watching. So,
the idea of a regional approach to this has been floated, but it hasn't gotten any traction either. That's akin. And this is an editorial, but it's akin to a national minimum wage. Is someone in New York City and someone in Wyoming? I mean, they just don't line up, and the state is pretty diverse in the same way. So the idea of the regional approach has fallen by the wayside. So I think that all we can do now is make our concerns known, but there's an awful lot of momentum on the side. You know, this is a bill that's been an issue anyway that's come before the General Assembly for past however many years, and this is something that was really put together in the interim, and clearly the unions are behind this. So it's got a lot of momentum. But on the other side, there were a lot of people that came out opposed to the bill as well. So the committee hasn't voted on it yet. But that committee chairman, Derek Davis, has made clear he wants to move the bill.
Is there anything we can do to influence it that you think? I don't see it in... Like you're saying, I mean, this is going to be shoved down our throats, and it's being pushed by the cities for all of their right reasons that they believe it should happen. But it's like Commissioner Boucher shared, is going to affect us. I don't think it's going to take too long to affect us once those wages start going up. Small businesses are just not going to be able to afford to keep their employees, and they're going to have to figure it out, either raising prices or moving. And you know, it's a shame that we're in this position, but if there's anything we can do, you know, through your insight, you know, to help influence us to really make a specific, you know, change to this, let us know.
Yeah, I think having the data is a key point to that. You just can't stand up and say I'm against it. You've got to really come through with some data to influence. And as you know, Prince George's and Montgomery counties have done it on their own over the past couple of years.
Of course.
And the body has moved left. You know, the progressive caucus has grown. So it doesn't look good. One of the bills that we were concerned about, HB 413, refers to the Public Information Act, and that it would open up and make discoverable confidential personnel records. Right now, complaints, disciplinary actions are all considered confidential personnel records. That bill would have opened that up to public discovery. MAKO and MML both worked pretty heavily with the sponsor, and it really only now applies to police officers. And frankly, that was the intent of the bill to begin with. It was brought forward by a Baltimore City delegate. And it's really aimed at the Baltimore City Police Department. So fortunately, the county governments, with the exception of police forces, have been amended out of that bill. I thought that was a win. One of the things I talked about last time I was up here were a couple of voter registration bills. One was same-day registration. The problem with that, aside from the fact that you would have probably need to staff these centers, was that a voter could go to any precinct and register and would be given, if it was not his or her precinct, would be given a provisional ballot. That's been amended now that the individual would have to register at their precinct. So I think that reduces some of the angst that folks had on that. But what effect that will have, maybe the Board of Elections has some insight there. Another bill was one that would reduce the threshold of registered voters in the county that would trigger the need for an additional early voting center. The threshold now of 100,000 is going to be raised to 120,000. That would have affected Carroll and would require a total of three, but the analysis suggests that through normal growth in registered voters, you would have crossed that threshold anyway without the bill. So it's likely you'll have to open a third, whether the bill would have moved forward or not. So another one that has a lot of folks concerned is HB 190 by Delegate Lafferty, is the definition of a failing septic system. And that was very broad. MACO has worked again with the sponsor, and in fact the hearing was this week, and Lee Broderick from the Bureau of Environmental Health testified on behalf of the Bureaus of Health and the health directors, and they have really narrowed that language and tightened it up, and those health directors are comfortable with the language as it stands now. The issue of cesspools still in there. That's considered a failing system. It's hard to argue against, argue in favor of cesspools, I would say.
We've had this conversation. The challenge is that we have folks in our community with cesspools, and they are functional. And if they need to transition to a septic tank or to get onto the sewage, it costs a lot of money. So within this bill or within this approach, there should be the recognition, how do we fund or get these folks the monies to do this? And, it's a shame that it's being forced again, something else being forced down our throats, that if it's working, let's continue to let it work, as opposed to recognizing we just don't like it, so it's now a failing system. And it's in my community, and I know it's throughout the county. So that was my opposition to this, and I believe the opposition, along with some others, to moving forward with this.
Yeah, and I think that one of the aspects of designated failing systems in the original bill, as it was drafted, was that it would trigger some pretty rigorous enforcement that would require, in other words, in many cases, require complete replacement of the system. Whereas now, with the language, it's been narrowed. It wouldn't allow, for example, small repairs or maintenance that needs to be done. So I can dig into this a little bit different. I believe that there are some existing programs that help citizens with that. I think that your particular constituent, I think, falls outside of some of those restrictions of that.
Correct.
Existing program.
There are existing programs, and they do address some of the funding and resourcing, but it's not enough. I mean, you can give somebody $10, but if it costs $100, they got to come up with the extra $90. And this, we're talking, with another zero at the other end, or two zeros at the other end. So it becomes very, very costly.
Yeah, particularly with a law that would require some significant changes to be made.
Exactly. Right? So I'm again, talking with others down there, trying to find incentivizing money and resources to allow folks to transition from a failing system that's now recognized as a failing system to something that's, you know, like a septic or something else. Right. So, okay. I appreciate the work you're doing.
Yep, so we'll continue to work on that one. So next week, some bills are coming up. Again, some election-related bills. Right now, in every polling place, you're required to have one ballot marking device that a disabled voter can use. There is a bill now that would require every voter to use one of those ballot marking devices, and I understand they're very expensive. So working that bill very hard, Mako's opposing that one as well.
Yeah, don't forget that all of these election bills, that's money that we don't have, that we've got to come up with. So, you know, there's several of them that are rolling through right now, and it's state mandates is what it is.
And the county fully funds the Board of Elections.
Right. So just keep that in mind. While some of these things might sound great, you know, like another polling place, everybody goes, yay, another early voting place. You all know how much that's going to cost us. So be thinking about where you're coming up with that amount. Go ahead.
Well, the same day voter registration, I didn't mention, that's a result of a referendum that occurred in the last election. So this is the bill that implements that requirement. A big bill on workman's compensation, Senate Bill 160, that adds bladder, kidney, or renal cell cancer to the types that are considered occupational diseases and so presumed to be suffered in the line of duty. So this is adding some additional diseases that some say have no definite connection to that line of work. So Mako's opposing that one. That has the potential to open up, again, another significant increase in what you need to fund. Our next generation 911 bill is coming up next week, and everybody's on board with that one. I believe that one of the concerns was about changing the way in which you submit your requests for equipment and are reimbursed for those, and it appears to me in the bill, and I'll double check that, but it appears to me that process remains the same, does not change. Another big bill, again with a cost to it, and that's the ones I'm bringing up to you are ones that have an impact on you. There's an awful lot of bills we could talk about, but these are the ones that I believe have an impact on you. HB 116 is medication-assisted treatment in detention centers. Delegate Barron from Baltimore City has brought that forward. That would require, and I don't have my notes, but if I remember correctly, that would require state and local detention centers to assess and begin treatment of an inmate who to assess them for opioid use disorder within 24 hours, and then put them on a regimen, and including upon their release, if the timing works out that way. And that bill there's been a work group formed between the counties and the state correctional people to continue to work on that, and they do continue to work on that and get that narrowed down a lot. So I can't give you a lot of information on the details because I actually just got the markup of the bill that they're working on, which is in progress. But I'll certainly share that as we get closer to taking that back to the committee. HB 645 is another special disability retirement allowance. This is the bill that Delegate Lasanti brought in last year. If you remember, it was an incident with a municipal officer in Harford County who was injured on the job and could not perform, and he was very close to being able to, within, I think, months of being able to claim full disability. And she brought the bill forward last year, but it really collapsed under its own weight. It was very onerous. Mako's worked very closely with the sponsor this year and whittled out, I think as you heard Michael Sanderson the other day at the legislative committee meeting, probably went from 100 to 15 in terms of what's still in that bill. So it is an impact to you, but they feel that they've gotten as much out of that as they can, and so Mako is supporting that bill, and that'll be heard next week. So what's coming? The things that are coming, the no net loss of forest. So there's a proposal to change within the Forest Conservation Act the definition of cover from canopy cover to forest cover, which is pretty significant. Right now, the state exceeds the standard it must meet under the FCA for canopy cover, but it's right at the margins when you look at forest cover. And these are contiguous forested areas, which are a challenge. The urban counties really have a problem with this because it takes their street trees out of it. That's not considered a forested area. So that's going to be a big issue coming forward. Solar siting. There are two bills, one in the House and one in the Senate, that are proposed to establish a commission to develop a blueprint for locating solar. You probably remember that these utility-grade solar installations would take up lots of land. I believe it was Kent County or one of the Shore counties had brought suit against the state because they believed that their local zoning was being disregarded in this. And there was a decision recently by the court that talks about the ability of the state occupying the field, as you will. So do they have the presumption to regulate this area, or does it fall to the counties? So that's out there now. The other thing is the environmentalists have a dilemma because they're pushing the renewable portfolio standard to increase, which is going to require a significant amount of solar. But also, if you put solar on productive farmlands or in sensitive areas, you've got that dichotomy. So I think the purpose of this commission ostensibly is to figure out how to direct these installations away from productive farmland, away from wetlands, away from critical areas and ecologically sensitive areas, and direct them to more brownfields, industrial areas, more urbanized areas. But the problem still exists there, that this blueprint could become a template that would be overlaid across the state and that local zoning would be set aside. So I think the arguments you're going to see coming from the local governments are, no, local zoning needs to be preemptive on this. It needs to be respected. So that's going to be coming.
Again, I think
very
we
shortly.
All agree with that. Absolutely. Yes. You know, full stop. Standing up this commission, we got to ensure that we have strong representation from those counties that want to really focus on protecting our rights, and that is our ability to zone the way we see fit, as opposed to this being forced down on us from the state. So that was a large part of the conversation.
It was.
And we just have to continue to push to ensure that we have the strong representation necessary, not necessarily to counter, but to show the argument of why there's value in us maintaining our rights.
You're absolutely right. I appreciate you reminding me of that because the local government representation is rather slim. It's, in my opinion, stacked on the side of
correct.
The solar
and that, developers. And we really have to, I think, be energized to ensure we have the right representation because we do not want we can't shut it down. It's going to happen, this commission, but we want to make sure that we have the ability to have a strong enough voice to to protect the things we want to protect.
I think we should possibly send a letter from the Board of Commissioners to the Commission saying what our point of view is and why. Because I don't believe that we should be overrun with our zoning should be pushed aside just to let something else come. I don't think it's the right thing to do. I think a letter from us, what probably would help in that regard.
Well, we can Absolutely. Do that. The Commission really hasn't been set up yet. They're working on that.
Right. The bill is to form
the bill is to form that. So when it comes to that, Commissioner Frazier, we can do that. Yes. And it's interesting because when you think about what they want to do, and I think it was our colleague from Queen Anne's, when you're talking about where do you want to put these things, there's only a couple places left that you could put what they're asking for, and that's the high-tension overhead lines that roll through a lot of our counties.
Right.
That's the only brown space that's left.
Yeah, when you do these large utility-grade solars, you've got to have transmission lines in proximity.
Right.
And basically, once you go out more than a mile, it becomes prohibitively expensive.
Right.
And it's also a challenge to build a transmission line, as you might imagine.
Exactly. So the point of that conversation was, why form a commission when that's all there is? It's the only place to put it. So anyway, more to come on that.
But that won't stop.
Well, I know.
Yeah, well, and that's, the point of these commissions, frankly, is to have stakeholder input.
Right.
But many of these issues are predetermined, so stay tuned. Also, part of that conversation yesterday, you reminded me, was the bill that would relieve the solar developers that are installing 2 megawatts or larger of paying property taxes, and in exchange they would pay annual fees. And while you don't have any, I don't believe you have any proposals for large scale solar, but in the counties that do, we're sharing that they were losing significant revenue by doing that, and that the solar developers had actually already built in the tax burden into their business plans. So obviously, we're opposing that one, and that probably will fall by the wayside. I say for last what I consider is the most impactful of all, and that's the Constitutional Amendment Environmental Rights. It's referred to as the Green Amendment. So, Delegate Lafferty, again, kind of the leader of the Environmental Caucus, is proposing a constitutional amendment that would, and I've got the language here because some of it, I think it's having the specific language is helpful. But it guarantees every person the right to a clean and healthy environment, including the right to clean water, pure air, a healthful environment, ecosystems that sustain the state's natural resources, preservation of the natural, scenic, historic, and aesthetic values of the environment. The state or a political subdivision of the state may not cause unreasonable diminution of or degradation to the state's natural resources by action or inaction, or infringe on the rights enumerated under here. So obviously the big concern is this is so broad that it could shut down just about any of the things that you do on a daily basis. It also gives anyone in the state standing. So you can have anyone in the state step in and file suit, if they will, or oppose any projects. As you probably saw, your staff put together a number of scenarios that they saw as possibly resulting from this, and we've passed that along to MACO. And I mentioned to the staff today, and I'll let you know that they provided a lot of examples. And when I passed them along, the word back was Carroll has provided far more detail than any other county. So the big concern is that if this passes, it goes to referendum. And if it goes to referendum, people won't have the benefit of understanding deeply what this really means, and
because it sounds
who's
good.
Against the environment, right? And I think your county is a perfect example of protecting the environment. I mean, I've got a list that was put together a talking points for me. It's just phenomenal on ag preservation and water quality. It's just, it's incredible. So I didn't want to end on a down note, but I just thought that was too important to pass up.
Well, that's kind of where we ended yesterday when we left Annapolis. So, you know.
That's true.
Sort of the common theme.
It is. It is a common theme.
Okay. I know that there's a couple other ones. House Bill 1053, you're looking into that one. That's the civil duty bill that you had brought our attention to, Tim, that on the surface requires anybody, whether trained or not trained, to stop and render aid.
Yeah. Very strange to me.
I'm not sure how that how that's going to coexist with the Good Samaritan law, but that has some ramifications to it, and I know Mako's looking at that now too.
Yeah, so there's a difference between not prosecuting someone for taking action or not taking action, but requiring them to take action.
Right. Does anyone know where that came from?
I don't. That's on my list to investigate.
I think one of my colleagues leaned over to me yesterday and said they think it was there's a result, which a lot of these bills are, many are, of an incident that occurred, and they called their legislator and said, look what happened to me. So then they put a bill in based on one incident. So I don't know whether that's true or not, but somebody leaned over to me yesterday at the table and said that. So
yeah, I haven't read it closely. I looked at it quickly, and I think it requires to render aid to police, fire, emergency services.
Yeah, that's specifically in there, too. I just kind of scanned it real quick yesterday and, you know, went, good grief.
Yeah, I'll dig into that one deeper.
Yeah, so, okay.
I do have one thing I want to bring up. I was going to bring it up later, but Mike's here. I'd like to share with it. I got a call this morning on the way in from Senator Hester and bill co-sponsored by Senator Rudy, which it would allow in labeling legislation for county school systems to collaborate with one another. And she would like to see if Carroll County would take a stand on this. I think the bill comes up Tuesday or Wednesday of this coming week, but she's going to try to get it delayed another week. And the only thing it allows for is systems for like a magnet school or something to be able to talk among each other. Right now they can't. And they were asking for in labeling legislation to let Carroll County talk to Howard County or Frederick County and if they wanted to develop something. So that was asked today. I did talk to the superintendent. He is supportive. He hasn't talked to his board yet, but he is supportive of at least looking into it. This does not bind us to anything other than allowing discussion to take place.
Yeah, I don't think it addresses physical school buildings. I think her intent is if there is a program that exists in one county that doesn't in another, and if you can use
that. I think the Carroll County and Littlestown School District do that with the Tech Center right now. But this was in Maryland for the counties to talk. So what I was asking for this board to at least take a stand and give her anything on that.
Yeah, well, I'll follow up with you on that. Maybe we'll scoot a letter off.
Yeah, we'll get you, I'll get you the bill, get you the details.
Yeah, that's Senate Bill 653. And we took the stance to support it yesterday at MAKO. There was an opposition, and then we scooted it to support after we heard some of the language. So we can follow up with a letter from here, too.
Yeah, I think some of the cost shifting associated with it, you're kept whole.
Are we all in support of this?
Yeah.
Well, I think so. I mean, anytime you can have collaboration between counties within a region for best practices, sharing resources, I mean, it's all a good news story. You know, there is a concern if you do start looking at resource allocation from one to another. That brings it to a different discussion. But this, I believe, is the collaborative approach to conversations and that kind of stuff. Mm-hmm. That's great news.
It does sound really good. I'd like to have the school board weigh in on it, to be honest with you.
Right.
But I do think it sounds like a step forward.
Yeah. I talked to the superintendent. He said he hadn't taken it to the school board yet.
That's
he hasn't had time. This caught
me kind
of off guard this morning.
Yeah, she's actually labeled it the Cross-County Attendance to Achieve Efficiency Act. Mm-hmm. So that really sounds fantastic. But here's the problem. There's going to be a whole lot of folks that get involved and want to add supplemental language to that. So we got to be very careful here with this thing. So let's see what the board says, but when it comes to the point, we'll scoot a letter if it's still, well, if the language is still within the sanity realm, you know?
And again, that's ensuring that we're not allocating funds and resources that will hamstring us to certain issues. I mean, the way this bill is let's talk. Let's share best practices and ideas, and that's a great thing.
At this time, it's very important.
That's on, it may be as early as Tuesday. She may need a letter.
Okay. Yeah, the hearing's for the 26th, so we'll see where that goes. Okay.
Be interesting to know what the Howard board feels. I assume
they are taking it to their board of ed. They haven't had a chance to either yet, so they are in the same situation we are in this. Right now, it's just discussion type thing. So. Okay. But it's just not between Howard and Carroll. This is
this would be statewide.
Jurisdictions in the state.
Yes.
Now, just to share, because it brings up a fundamental issue, and that is having good conversations with our delegation, both in 9 and 5 and 4, for that matter, the state delegations, and having that rapport. You know, the opportunity for us to be down there on Wednesdays is great, and we could do that eye-to-eye, face-to-face. Mm-hmm. But also to ensure that the delegation knows and we know open communications and discussions. So, you know, as example from this morning you had with Senator Hester, that's great stuff, and we continue to do that. So.
Yeah, I think we should work on a strategy for taking advantage of the time we spend in Annapolis together.
Yeah, I agree with that, and I'll take that to one final rung on the ladder. I've asked Mike to put together the number of the bills that our legislation has either sponsored or, most importantly, signed on as co-sponsors. And I think some of you may be surprised as to where the party lines are down there. So while it all sounds great and we can hold hands and sing Kumbaya, I think you all need to see what's going on down there. So I've asked Mike. He's put that together. I'm going to share that with all of you. Because I'll just leave it at that.
I just want Mike to be aware where we are in that, so you don't get blindsided.
Yeah, she spoke about that at Leadership Carroll luncheon the other day.
Okay, anything else for Mike?
That's it.
We might want to put him a little bit more time on the schedule in the next couple weeks, because in the middle of this activity in Annapolis, I think maybe a little bit more time.
A lot of impactful legislation.
And the engagement here that we have is very beneficial for all of us. So might want to just scoot a little bit of extra time for Mike. So okay.
I see you. I see you two a lot, but the other three gentlemen, it's good to get a little closer to on a regular basis.
Okay.
Good.
Thanks, Mike.
Thank you. Keep up the good work.
Thank
you.
Yeah.
All right. I think this is the last agency hearing, if I'm not correct.
I believe so.
And we're going to talk weeds. Weed control.
He's been very patient this morning.
He has been very patient.
I've learned a lot.
Legislature affects us, too.
Yes, absolutely. It does. So good morning.
Good morning. I'm Peter Rupp. I do the administrative work for Carroll County's weed control program, Howard County's and Frederick County's. So I keep busy. Previously, I worked for the Department of Agriculture as a weed control, that part, but they downsized and I retired, so you got me. I don't know how familiar you all are with the noxious weed law, but there are various species of thistle, Johnson grass, and shatter cane that are deemed noxious. That means they're regulated. They cannot go to seed and you cannot move the rootstock from one property to another. This law started with Johnson grass in the late 60s. Thistles came on in the late 70s, early 80s. There is actually a fine and also possible jail time for somebody that does not cooperate. It could ultimately go to the state's attorney. They would file charges.
that be for weed possession?
Depends what you're talking about.
That's a whole nother matter.
Get the language right, Counselor.
At the moment, that is very, very seldom has ever happened. It's usually some education and some nice official-looking letters take care of the issues. In the last couple of years, there's been Palmer Amaranth has moved into this state. I don't know if you're aware of it. It's a weed that's come up from the south. It's worked its way across from actually desert areas. It's very resistant to any herbicides.
What's it called again?
Palmer Amaranth. It's a like a pig weed on steroids. It produces approximately 500,000 to a million seed per plant.
It's on the shore. They're really having
it's on the shore and in southern Maryland.
If it gets a hold on things, it's really hard to control.
There's a bill in the House right now, I think it's 818, to modify the weed control program to make it easier to add weeds to the noxious weed list. As it is now, it's got to go through the assembly, so it's very onerous.
It's too late the time it gets passed many times.
Well, that's about it. It's So this bill, if it does eventually work its way through, it might take another year, would change the penalties, but it would leave it up to the Secretary of Agriculture to add things as necessary, so you'd have a much more rapid response.
The one you're talking about here, if it's over 10 inches in height, pesticides are almost impossible to deal with. And identifying it at that height, and it gets 10 feet tall, I would understand.
It can get 10 feet tall, inches. It's, some people say 3 or 4 inches, and herbicides really won't enough.
Is it pretty?
No.
It's not even pretty weed.
Pretty ugly.
Sometimes the weeds are pretty with
And people are allergic to some of it, I understand, can be with the...
I'd imagine it has some skin irritation. There's some other ones like giant hogweed, which is very devastating to your skin. But that's not in Carroll County. The closest it is down in Baltimore County, Gunpowder River area. That's one aspect of it. Another one is we run spray crews in these counties to control the noxious weeds on public lands. We assist farms, private landowners. We do the state roads, county roads, parks, wherever we're needed. These are all for fees, and the fees are what pay for the program. We actually can move our assets, our equipment, from one county to another for a big project, because it's foolish to have way more equipment in one county that you don't use than and you have it in another one the next county. We just work together. But it's a cooperative program. We work with, Cooperative Extensive Service. We work with everybody. We hire a fair number of students in the summer. We were able to hire, say, 17-year-olds, but now the laws are being changed. They have to be 18. I've had great cooperation in this county, all the counties, and it's always been a pleasure to come over here. But I'll be glad to answer any questions you have.
I see your crew or you guys out a good bit, especially in the spring and summertime.
Right.
And I've had constituents say, What are those guys doing when they're spraying out the window of the truck? Because that's kind of what you guys do. So
right. Usually it's
good to know that, to have that knowledge, Peter, to be able to share that information. So,
I mean, generally, especially on county roads, the right-of-ways are not very wide. They don't want to spray into private people's properties. That opens up a whole other set of issues. So they're trying to control from the property line out. And if they see issues well beyond that property line, then they let me know and we'll discuss it with the person that's got the problem.
Okay. Any other questions?
Do a great job.
Well, I certainly thank you. And we thank you for the wonderful support.
Absolutely.
We'd hear it if you didn't.
Yeah, exactly.
And if you have complaints, come in. Please refer them to us.
Yep, we will.
Thank you.
All right. Thank you, Mr. Rupp. Appreciate it.
Glad to help.
Okay. Next item on our agenda is National Marketing Plan, and we'll invite our Director of Economic Development, Mr. Jack Lyburn, to share
out of the weeds.
To get us out of the weeds.
Out of the weeds.
That's pretty good. That's pretty good.
Commissioners, thank you. Before we go into the National Marketing Plan, you're going to hear about we're marketing all over the United States and even a couple of foreign countries here, but our number one program and a part of our program is still retention. And we've been very successful with all your help in the last couple of years. The Strauss Corporation expanded, Fairlawn stayed and expanded. Ibapco, as you know, a huge expansion. Random House, another huge expansion. Knorr Break stayed with another huge expansion. So retention has been our number one priority. And the good news is we have three manufacturers, major manufacturers here in Carroll County, which we're working through right now. And we've seen plans on two, and we're getting another one. And they're talking about hiring 230 new jobs. So within the next 60 days, we'll announce them. And these are manufacturing jobs. These are high-paying jobs. And this is retention. This is still our number one priority. Why are they coming, and why are we expanding here? The economy is good. Manufacturing is good in Carroll County. And the wage rates are high. We're talking about, you know, starting salaries of $40,000 to $60,000 in at least manufacturers and some of the engineering and CAD operators. Labor, we have labor, even though we're number two and number three in the unemployment rate, we still have 60,000 people every day that leave Carroll County. We have the labor of manufacturers, and everyone recognizes that. And what I want to do now is give you the program to go to the national program. But just remember, too, our number one priority is always retention, taking care of what we have here in the county.
It's how to retain that information.
Thank you, Joe.
Right place, right time. Carroll's always been the right place in the right time. We very rarely do we deal with a company that's looking to come here or one of our retention. We have to deal with state locators and brokers. And since we're on a real roll here, and if we keep the momentum that we have, we're gonna run out of land, zoned property land. And you've taken care of that in the last couple months by giving us some of the properties which we're going to promote. What we're going to do is with this package, and you can see the stick that's there, and you've seen the marketing program, that's that 8-minute video. We're going to send this out to the 32 local agencies here and brokers and site locators, and then we're going to send them out to 95 national site locators and brokers throughout the United States and even some in Germany and France, which we're seeing a lot of German companies. And we're also gonna send them to some companies and site locators in Shanghai, because we've gotten two Chinese companies and we're talking to another one. What we're gonna do is promote, you can see the first property here is the Delaney property. That's the one you just a couple weeks ago, it was 65 acres. North Carroll Business Park, Commissioner, we're gonna have 45 acres for sale, and we should be breaking ground this summer on this. And we still have 11 acres next to Fuchs. Warfield, which is the gem down in South Carroll, we're working with the developer. The 145 townhouses are being built as we speak. They're moving ground, you can see in the lower right-hand corner. And then we have office square footage, and then we have site locators, and we're working with the commissioner and working with Roger Connolly. West Branch Trade Center is out on Route 97, and then Westminster Technology Park is on Route 97. We're sending this package out, like I said, to the site locators and brokers throughout the United States. and a couple in Asia and Europe. And after we do that, we're going to call them up and have lunch with them. We're going to go down to the college and Skype them, and we're going to go. We're going to watch the video together in about a couple dozen of these, and we're going to go through the parks and let them know we're here, and let everybody know that we're here. We're open for business, and we need to put your manufacturing business in here and whatever else. But our marketing is our plan is manufacturing. It seems like we have a real niche in the state for manufacturing. Not so much warehousing or biotech, but we do have two of our larger biotech companies now to talk about major expansions. We'll be working with them. So I just thought I'd go over this with you, and I will be going over to like a Trammell Crow in Washington and going to some of the larger brokerage houses down in Baltimore and actually having lunch with them and going through the brokers. Last week, we went down to Commerce and talked to the 22 representatives that they have. Very receptive, and they will be marketing these five sites. And we even got a lead yesterday. We were the commissioner and I were down. It was Economic Development Day in Annapolis yesterday. So we heard about the minimum wage, and I guess I'll be down there testifying on a couple bills. The MEDAF bill, they're asking for an increase in MEDAF. MEDAF is like the engine that funds all our companies up here when they get incentives from the state, and also PWQ, which is a training money. I'll be testifying. They're asking for $1 million increase in that. So we're excited about the program. We're going to be aggressive. We think now's the time to do it. The economy's strong, and it's been strong for us in Carroll County. And instead of sitting back and waiting for them to come, we're going to go after them this time. Questions?
If I can just add a couple comments.
Okay.
One, I appreciate all that you and your team are doing. When folks ask you, or would ask me, how am I doing? I'm like, well, don't ask me. Ask the people I'm serving. And yesterday at MEDA, where you and I were in Annapolis, the people that we're serving were speaking up. And those that are, at the state, both the Secretary Schultz and also Deputy Secretary Wu highlighted the work that you and your team are doing here in Carroll County, and that we are serving the county, we're serving the state and the region. So that's kudos to you and your team moving forward. They highlighted, they being especially Secretary Wu or Deputy Secretary Wu, the work you're doing with manufacturing, and that we are, the poster child for manufacturing in the state. We are just making things happen, we being you and your team. So I appreciate all the work you're doing and highlighting these parcels, along with everything else you're doing from small business to large business like this. So thank you.
Well, Commissioner, it takes the whole village, and you're part of this team. So you passed the legislation, and you've all helped me with closing some deals, and we have a couple exciting, let's say, prospects that hopefully we'll be announcing to the manufacturers. Yeah.
Jack, we know that your staff makes you look good.
That's 100% true.
So you've done a great job in the past. We've had tremendous economic development in the past 4 or 5 years. I really appreciate what you've done, but I was kind of very excited when you said about Europe and Asia. I thought we were going to make a trip over, but I guess that's not going
to
happen.
No, I'm not going to make a trip to Europe and Asia.
Because I was going to volunteer to go with you. That's
okay. You're welcome to go to Shanghai, 26 hours in the air. The state will, on our behalf, be going over there. Same with the Paris Air Show and Germany. A lot of our companies, our newer companies, are from Germany. So they're doing it on our behalf. We're very sensitive to taxpayers' dollars. And me traveling to there, I don't think that's the best bang for the dollar.
No, and leveraging Department of Commerce's resources, the state's resources like you do, that's the way to get it done. As you visited last week, talking to those 22 folks, within Department of Commerce, knowing that those in Department of Commerce in the state also are some of our constituents here in the county, and they are well aware of the work you're doing. So using those resources to the best, and again, kudos.
But I won't hesitate to go if I think the deal is doable.
Absolutely.
Either. As you know, I have done that.
Well, I've learned that this county has a very low amount of commercial industrial property tax base relative to other counties. So this is so critical to take the pressure off a residential property tax base. And manufacturing produces the best paying jobs for our citizens, which we reap the reward from expanding our income tax on that. So I'm very, very grateful that you're addressing this and doing so well, because it's something I'd campaigned on. So thank you.
Thank you. We think we have the niche, and we definitely have the labor. And one of the Commissioner Wentz was talking to one of his constituents, and he said the great part about it is, you told the story better than I did, is that now we're only 10 minutes from my house, and I don't have to travel an hour, and I can spend time. I can go to my kids' soccer games, and I can, you know, be involved in the school programs. And, you know, I can tell you, somebody asked me what economic developers do, and I say we change people's lives. We have changed over 2,000 lives in the last 2 years because they have jobs, and they have high-paying jobs. So my new theme is we change people's lives. So thank
good,
you.
Good stuff.
And I'm going to stay here because Denise has some really good news for you.
Yep. Yeah, so that's next. Thanks, Jack. Request approval to accept the Opioid National Health Emergency Grant funding for Burke. Denise?
Good morning.
Good morning.
Morning.
We're here because Burke has been awarded $25,000 from the U.S. Department of Labor's National Emergency Health Grant that was funneled through the Department of Labor Licensing and Regulations. We plan to work with individuals that are in recovery from the opioid epidemic and getting them employment, be it pre-employment training, or, you know, whatever services that they need to help them keep on that positive path.
Excellent.
Good.
On the briefing paper you have, it says that they provide outreach to eligible individuals. How do you become an eligible individual?
Well, we're going to be working with drug treatment court and the health department that's going to identify those individuals that would be most benefit from our services. So eligible is, it's pretty broad, you know, right, if they're affected by the opioid crisis.
My thing is that if someone's affected by the opioid crisis, we generally, well, I say we as a country basically, not just state or Carroll County, don't give them help until it's almost too late.
Right.
So when it says eligible individuals, I would like to see people that are just getting started or just starting to be affected by the opioids, so forth, get help immediately. Don't have to wait just to be in drug court. They don't have to wait to be arrested. They don't have to wait to be whatever.
Right.
You know, if someone can come in and say, I'm having trouble with this or that, can they get that help? Or do they have to have some type of something happen to them first?
Well, this grant is not for treatment.
No, I know that.
Yeah.
But it's for jobs.
If
they have
yes.
jobs,
but usually
it helps
they have
well.
To focus on recovery. You know, that's a, you know, a recovery in itself is a priority before they can really focus
right.
on employment. So, but, you know, at any stage, we're going to be there. You know, we're going to use our professionals that work with the individuals that are struggling with that to make those judgment calls on who to refer. Mm-hmm. But I agree. You're right. Yeah.
So the state got $1.9 million of this from the federal government?
Excuse me?
The state got $1.9 million from the federal government, and Carroll County gets $25,000.
Well, yes, but there's we're hopeful that we can apply for additional funds there.
I mean, every bit helps. It just seems like our bit is kind of small.
I'll move the Board of Commissioners accept the FY 2019 Opioid National Health Emergency Grant Award.
Second.
Any other discussion? All in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Thank you.
Thank you.
The commissioners, you talked about the team. Burke has seen had over 10,000 visits last year.
Yeah.
So
even though the unemployment rate is low, there are still individuals that are coming in and using our resources. So.
Important member of the team.
Yep.
Thank you.
Y'all do a great job over there.
Thank you.
Okay. Next on the agenda. Overview and challenges. Ted, you don't have any challenges.
Opportunities.
Right. What he said.
opportunities.
Our Department of Citizen Services. Our director, Christine Kay, and I'm sure she's brought lots of folks behind the scenes, so I'll let you do the introductions for everybody.
Okay.
So.
Good morning.
Good morning.
So, Commissioners, this morning we're going to give you an overview of our programming and services in citizen services. Celine and Danielle are going to present data and highlights from each of our departments with an emphasis on the depth of our services and the positive impact that we see they're making in the community. Then I'm going to discuss what I feel are our greatest challenges in within the department. So I'll pass it over. Joining us today, well, let me go back. I should probably do introductions, right?
Yeah, be a good thing.
Okay, thanks.
I mean, if you want me to do it, I'll do it.
But you don't need it to be introduced. Danielle Yates is our Bureau Chief of Housing and Community Connections, and Celine Steckel is our Bureau Chief of Aging and Disabilities, and we have our housing supervisor joining us today, Paul Moffitt, if you have any questions, and Gina Valentine from Aging and Disabilities Supervisor, and Jen Quick, who is my right hand, is also with us today.
So thank you for doing that. That was for sure. The 10,000 folks that are viewing us, okay? Thanks, Christine.
Sure.
Okay.
So now I'll pass it over to Danielle.
Good morning, Commissioners. So Carroll County Housing and Community Development services families in Carroll County that are in the extremely low to moderately low income bracket. As you can see from the next slide that we have, there are a multitude of services that we actually offer through the Housing Choice Voucher Program. Our housing agency actually administers 681 tenant-based vouchers, which serve about 1,190 citizens who either work or live in Carroll County. A question that we always seem to get is exactly who is it that we serve at the Public Housing Authority? I'd like to emphasize that 90% of our voucher holders are either older adults or individuals with disabilities. In addition, there is a very thorough eligibility screening that each family must go through to actually get into the program and accomplish or succeed annually to ensure that they are still eligible for our program. The Carroll County Housing Choice Voucher Program actually began in Carroll County in about the early 1980s as a certificate program. In about 2000, what we did is we saw that the program actually evolved into the Housing Choice Voucher Program that it is today. The housing program has actually been in existence and funded for 39 years. Our program is funded completely with federal dollars. When the federal budget is actually approved annually, there is an allocated amount that each public housing authority receives through HUD. Our housing authority receives just a little bit over $6 million a year. $5.5 million of that funding is for program funds. And what that basically is the rental subsidy assistance that we provide for each of our families. We get $600,000 for all program administrative funds. With that $600,000, we are able to support all program administrative funds to run our public housing authority, including the salary and fringe for all 8 of our housing employees. Celine now is going to share some information with you regarding the Bureau of Aging and Disabilities.
Good morning, Commissioners.
Well, I apologize.
Yes, sir.
Do we have enough vouchers to service our community?
No.
Or is that something that we're going to
get to? On our current wait list, we have over 1,800 families. So from the time you apply to the time you actually come in for an eligibility screening right now, we are averaging a little over 2 years.
So we have about 35% vouchers to the need. To the need.
Correct. About so, yes.
And over the past year and a half or so, we've added 30 vouchers. 10 of those for VASH. And
22 for the mainstream, so 32.
Veteran assisted supportive housing.
So we've added about 2-3% of a need, but there's still, we're only
a greater need, yes.
35%, give or take, you know,
yes.
Mm-hmm. Of the actual need for our community, where there, you said there was 1,800 and some.
There's a little over 1,800 families on the wait list currently today.
So there's actually 2,500 total population. So we're really like a 20 some odd percent.
Yes.
Okay.
Wow. So where do they go in the meantime?
Well, a lot of times we defer them to HSP Human Services Program, where they have different rental subsidy assistance programs that they can try to help in the short term until we're able to service them. So we're always making connections with other agencies to try to find that assistance until they're able to come up on our list.
They could also be doubled up with other family members. Right. You know, until their voucher comes through.
Yeah, but I think it's a great question. Understanding the services you provide and the value we're adding is great. Understanding the requirements that are still out there for our community that is not being served because of our limitations and resources is very important to walk ourselves through. So I appreciate it.
Maybe there are challenges then. Okay, sorry.
That's okay. I wanted to talk a little bit about the Bureau of Aging and Disabilities and the services that we provide. We are responsible for a wide range of programs and services for older adults age 60 and over and people with disabilities of any age, veterans, and also people that care for any of those individuals. We operate through our Bureau of Aging and Disabilities out of our offices and into the community, and we also operate 5 senior and community centers in Carroll County, which are staffed with 15 staff total, 3 per center at our senior centers, and those staff are all full county employees. The Bureau of Aging and Disabilities is authorized as the Local Area Agency on Aging, or otherwise called the AAA, legislated through the Older Americans Act of 1965 and its subsequent reauthorizations. The Older Americans Act established the authority for grants to states for community planning, social services to adults, research and development projects, and training in the field of aging. The AAA is charged as the on-the-ground organization to help vulnerable older adults to live independently with dignity in their homes throughout the community. In fiscal year 18, the Bureau of Aging and Disabilities served over 7,500 Carroll County citizens through our client services programs, while the 5 senior and community centers expanded to over 55 registered active members in the centers. Through our programs and centers, the Bureau serves some of our most vulnerable citizens in Carroll County, individuals that may be victims of elder abuse, financial scams, people that need financial and legal assistance. We provide services to individuals that may just need to have a hot meal or socialization or programs in our centers for fitness or health-related issues and health screenings. This chart that I have in front of you now represents the funding that we have, state and federal, that comes through in the form of grants and the services that we provide related to those funding streams. So as you can see, each grant provides many services through the funds that we are given. The Bureau of Aging and Disabilities receives federal, state, county, and private grant dollars. As you can see with the chart, 48% of our funding that we receive out of our total allocation is from county dollars. 25% of our funding is through federal dollars, 24% is through state funding, and 3% is through local grant dollars that are provided to us from private funding that supports our Veterans Services Program. I'm now going to turn this over to Christine to continue with her discussion about our department.
It's only really one I want to focus on. Any questions for Celine about the aging programs?
No, the only question that I would have, I know that our senior centers have 3 folks that are on staff there. Is that a reasonable number for the amount of folks that you're seeing that are utilizing? I know what the answer is going to be. Maybe I'm prompting you, but I know that a lot of our senior centers, especially one in Mount Airy, and of course the one in Tawnytown too, has grown with a lot of the things that they do. But what's your take on that?
So those 3 individuals that staff the center. So there are 2. There's 1 center manager, 1 assistant manager, and then 1 custodian. The custodian comes in the afternoon and works through the evening so that they're there during the times when there's less individuals in the facility so that they can do the cleaning. And so there's less individuals there. The answer to that is difficult. It does make it difficult to staff the centers and to provide the breadth of service that we want to within our centers with only 2 staff, especially when you with the 2 managers in the building. But we do make it work. We pull on other resources within the Bureau of Aging and Disabilities to make that work. Would additional staff help? At least 1 per center, I would say yes, but I think where we are now currently, we do make it work.
How about the volunteer aspect of it? Is that see that?
We have...
Increasing, staying the same? Where are you with that?
Pretty much, it's staying a little bit the same, but also we're hoping to increase our volunteer base in the centers. We could not run our senior centers without our volunteers. We have hundreds of volunteers, and in each center every day, we have committed volunteers that come in and help with our meal program, our front desk reception. And if we didn't have those volunteers, our meal programs could not run, because we have our assistant manager that is in the back making sure that the nutrition program is set up, that everything is coordinated, the donations are coming in, the meals are prepped and kept at the stabilized temperatures they need to be served to the individuals. And without those volunteers, we could not make sure that was all being accomplished.
Okay. I mean, again, it's a testament to the community. You know, we are not a charity, but we are very charitable, and our community is very charitable by giving their time, these volunteers, and these approaches. So, you know, definitely could not do it without those volunteers. Appreciate
it. Exactly right.
Sharing that.
Thank you. So, commissioners, as you know, we interact with some of the most vulnerable citizens in the county. Our colleagues deal with difficult and challenging situations every day. They are literally putting out fires on a daily basis. I'd like to take just a minute to thank Celine and Danielle for leading our staff in a productive, results-driven, and most importantly, compassionate manner. We have a staff of about 60 dedicated individuals who work tirelessly every day to help better the lives of thousands in our community. Which brings me to what I feel is our greatest challenge within the department. And it's probably no surprise to any of you when I say that is contingent versus regular status for our employees. Let me give you a little history of what contingent status means. Approximately 10 years ago, the county established a new category for employees hired under a grant called contingent. The main difference between contingent employee and a regular employee is that contingent staff do not receive pension benefits, retiree health care, or have the same accrued leave policy. Contingent staff earn PTO only. At that time, existing employees within the Department of Citizen Services were grandfathered into the system, and we still have a handful of positions that are currently regular status, but any new grant contingent position or vacancies are now filled under this new procedure with an employment contract. Approximately 51% of the staff within the Department of Citizen Services are contingent, and once all of the positions that are grandfathered eventually turn over, our workforce in citizen services will be about 61% contingent. Keep in mind that prior to this time, 100% of citizen services staff were regular county employees receiving full county benefits. I bring this to your attention because this is obviously a very important issue to my colleagues within the department. 3 years ago, when I started in this position, I met with each staff member one-on-one. It took about 10, 15 minutes with every staff member and to talk about challenges and strengths within our department. 100% of the staff noted that their biggest concern is the contingent status within our department and how that affects the services that we provide to the community. I say this again because it was very telling to me. I mean, I tell you, every person I met with said, whether they were a regular county staff or contingent, that they were concerned about the contingent status. So I felt it was something that we needed to research and look into. Some of the main issues and concerns was turnover. Now, I would say off the bat that turnover is not the only reason, but it's definitely a byproduct and a factor of the turnover in our department. Training and inconsistent services to our constituents. When we have vacancies, staff are doubling up on responsibilities, and we're unable to provide the same level of service. In the past year and a half, we've seen a 90% turnover just in housing. Now, I say again, I know that turnover is not 100% because of contingent staff, but it's definitely, the top three, you know, reasons. In the past year, we've seen four front desk staff at housing, two of them turned over specifically because they came from a contingent position and were able to find another position within the county at regular status. So you could probably see that this is an issue we've become very passionate about. I feel that since I've started and have really spent time looking into this, that all of the positions in the department, that not all of the positions are coded correctly. I understand that at the time, 10 years ago, there were reasons for converting these positions, and I also agree there's a place for contingent positions within the county and even within Department of Citizen Services. However, there are many I feel that were incorrectly converted within our department. A couple of things I'd like for you to think about. Typically, when we come before you and we have our grant and we're asking for a grant renewal, we'll get the question, well, what happens if the grant dollars go away? And I typically give you the same response, which is, well, if the grant dollars go away and the service goes away, unfortunately, the position then may have to go away. And that is all still very accurate. However, I do think that and based on what you heard from Celine and Danielle, that these dollars have proven to be very consistent and have held the test of time. We have secured these dollars for decades, of course, but I know there are no guarantees. One question I think we should consider, or that you all should consider, is regardless of the funding, some of the programs and services are so important that regardless of the funding, would the county continue to support those programs if those federal and state dollars were to cease? If the answer is yes, then I think that's telling us that you're willing to make a long-term commitment to the programs. And that's really a question that you all would need to discuss. All of you, and I know boards before you, have supported the work of Citizens Services and in both bureaus. We've had many conversations about the services we provide. I know you see the value of the services and need within our community. Over the years, grant requirements have become more complex and demanding. We're putting more and more work and responsibility on staff to ensure we meet grant requirements and constituents' needs. I feel if we want to continue providing these vital services, we need to do it correctly. I think it's time to look at the structure of the contingent positions and determine if the contingent status truly makes sense. Believe it or not, I do have a plan. But first, I'd like to acknowledge that we have worked with HR to improve the benefits of the contingent staff. We have increased the amount of PTO received. We've added short-term disability, comp leave, and bereavement leave. But I do think we need to do more. The Department of Citizen Services is a division within Carroll County government, yet over half of our employees are not receiving the benefits that regular employees do. We are asking if you're willing to make the investment in the programs, then we make the same investment in our colleagues. I hear it time and time again and see it firsthand, the detriment it has to our services, and we are asking that during budget season we review the positions and possibly convert positions back to full county. This is really just a briefing today and to answer any questions. We'll be coming back in March to our budget hearing where we'll be kind of introducing a three-phase process of and our priority of positions that we'd like to see converted. Questions?
How many hours are you talking about in these positions a year?
I'm sorry?
How many hours of grant positions are there?
Well, we have, so department of, our department has 23 contingent positions. That does not include, we also have a handful of contractual positions. We are 62% countywide. We have the largest number of contingent positions countywide, which is about 62%. Most, they're all full-time.
But that's due to grants, and most of them, correct?
It is due to grants, but the other thing I did mean to point out is that our funding is allocated. All our funding and aging is allocated. Mm-hmm. Our funding and housing is allocated. So we're not competing for those dollars every year. Right. We're renewing the funding. We're renewing the allocation. So, which is why, like Danielle said, you know, we've been receiving the housing dollars for almost 40 years. We've been receiving most of our aging dollars for 20 to 30 years. And what we typically see is if dollars dry up in one area, they tend to show up somewhere else, or they're allocated in a different way.
Do you have any reason to believe they won't show up somewhere else if they do go away?
Okay. I mean, no, like this.
How many hours we're talking about in this whole package?
I don't think hours are really, these people are, for the most part, these positions are full-time positions.
Full-time, okay.
And it's 23 positions.
Yeah. Okay.
I was wondering what the price tag is and how Ted feels about it, and he stands up to the mic. So let's hear from Ted.
This is a topic Christine and I have talked about extensively, and I think she did a good job of laying this out. I do want to make a couple points, though. You know, understandably, Christine is approaching this from the point of view of citizen services, and fully acknowledge these positions are a burden to them. It makes their life more difficult. The reason they exist was to leave more flexibility in your hands, to put the county in a better position if something were to change and we had to deal with it. Now, in theory, if you looked at all these positions and said, you know what, we don't care where the money's coming from, we're glad money is coming from somewhere else, but even if it wasn't coming from somewhere else, we would continue doing all the things these positions are doing, then that would argue, make them all regular positions, and we wouldn't have this discussion anymore. I'm not sure that I would be able to get there, but it's possible. I think as you consider these, you need to look at this two ways, and this will be coming to what you just asked in a second. There's a position by position, philosophical position, position decision for you to make. Are we willing to say that if the money that supports this position today goes away, we would be okay devoting county tax dollars to replacing that money? On the positions where you make that choice, then you have a second choice, which is, can we afford to do it? Yeah, we think we ought to do it, but do we have the money to do it? I've never actually calculated if they all just became regular, what that would be. And it's not even an easy calculation, because some of this is uncertain money. When you look at pensions and retiree health benefits, we don't know what those are. You know, we make estimates of the future, but we can't tell you what those costs are going to be. But when you take on people who have long-term liabilities, clearly you have taken on some greater commitment and some greater risk to the budget. So like Christine said, she's not asking for a decision today. She'll be looking for you to consider this as you go through the budget process. So if you give it any thought, I would just say think about it two ways. When you look at the positions, do you believe the county ought to commit to this position, even if there's no funding? And then think about, how does this rank against other things that you might be thinking about in your budget decisions? Because, you know, we're still left with that same basic problem. There's really no extra money. So everything we want to devote more money to, we have to figure out how we're going to pay for it.
Ted, when we're figuring out if we're going to, how we're going to spend this money, it's important to note, and I want to make sure I understand this correctly, that the contingent positions that we're talking about and bring forth in March, are their current everyday salary are covered by the grants or are already in our general fund budget. So the long-term costs are really the pension costs and those post-employment, correct?
Right.
But there's really no present danger of these going away in the next month or two.
I'm sorry?
You said there's really no present danger of these going away in the next month or whatever.
I don't believe so. Okay. You know, all but right. I, you know, not going.
Yeah, and even going back to when this was first set up, and to go back to one point Christine made, you know, I won't stand here and argue the county, made the right choice on every one of these positions when we identified it. There's a lot of it's debatable, could have ended up with a different list than we did. Forgot what I was going to say now. What was the last thing you said, Christine?
I said
he was out late last night.
In reviewing this in March, when we come before you with some of the positions we'd like to convert, that the grants are currently and will continue to cover their salaries. The issue is the post-employment.
Christine Weaver said, yeah, even when we set this up, it was not because of any concern of imminent loss of revenue. This was a very long-term look at things to say, do we want to be making a long-term commitment when we're not the ones controlling the money? So this was never about, we're worried about a grant. It wasn't about how do we balance next year's budget. It was really about how does this work for us over the years? What commitments do we think we ought to make?
Okay. Certainly do appreciate the information. Obviously, you and all the departments know that we address these things in March when we begin the budget talks. And certainly, again, gives us a little bit of time, I guess, to digest what you're going to be presenting in March. But I'd like to leave it at that.
Sure.
Okay?
Yep.
Anything else?
No, thank you.
Okay,
thank you.
Thanks for the overview. Appreciate it. Okay.
Challenge, not
opportunity. Yeah. All right. Next on our agenda, and we're ahead of time, so hopefully, Gail's here. Request approval for grant application and acceptance of award, Chesapeake Bay Trust Restoration Research Award Program. Is there an acronym for that?
That's a lot.
Because that's a whole lot to say, Gail. So
it's better than NPDES, right?
Our Bureau Chief of Resource Management, Gail Engels.
So good morning, Commissioners.
Morning.
Morning.
We're here today to request approval for the submission of a grant application to the Chesapeake Bay Trust for their restoration research grant program. We also want to request acceptance of that grant award if we do receive that, probably sometime in June. One other thing I want to bring to your attention, we do show a consultant grant, or what we're going for as far as the money is involved. That consultant is not someone that's on board currently. That would be brought to you later if we do receive the grant funding. We will come and then discuss that and the consultant and that sort of thing at that point in time if we do get the funding. So Kelly Martin is here, our grants analyst. She's going to go over a little bit about the application. And then Byron Madigan, our water resource supervisor, is here to discuss actually what we're going to be doing with that monitoring program.
Okay. Morning.
So the Bureau of Resource Management is requesting the board's approval to submit an application to the Chesapeake Bay Trust for $111,177. This project will be done in partnership with the Center for Watershed Protection and will monitor two types of stormwater best management practices and their ability to reduce temperature impacts to receiving streams. Results from the study will determine if implementation of stormwater management wet pond retrofits can reduce stream temperatures similar to results found using wetland systems. This information will be used to assist the county in its design of restoration projects to address the requirements of the National Pollutant Discharge Elimination System permit, specifically in use 3 and 4 waters. The grant request is $111,177 with a county in-kind match for staff and equipment of $21,500 for a total project cost of $132,677.
Okay. Okay. As Gail and Kelly mentioned, this falls right in line with our impervious mitigation requirements for stormwater. Carroll County has a significant amount of what they call use 3 and 4 streams, which are cold and cool water streams. Carroll County has over 1,000 miles of streams, and about 86% of them are use 3 and use 4 watersheds. These are capable of supporting natural trout populations or put and take trout populations for fishermen. The problem with that is the state will not permit wet facilities for our stormwater program in these areas over concern of the thermal impact from the radiation in the ponds heating up, holding water, and to these cold water streams, which greatly reduces kind of our options for implementation when working in these different areas. So what this study will do is we'll look at innovative design modification to wet ponds that has the potential to reduce these thermal impacts from our facilities, which will allow us greater flexibility when working in these particular watersheds for our NPDES program.
So we want more brook trout, right?
I mean, this grant is for a consultant.
Simmer down, Tom.
Right.
Grant will cover the consultant cost associated with the study.
It's paying for a consultant. Mm-hmm. That's what this is focused on.
That's correct.
And I know this is a big issue, whether water treatment or wherever, trying to keep that temperature, the right temperature to go back in. And it's an issue I know you guys have all been dealing with for years. And that was just a smart comment I made on the brook trout here. So
I thought we had done some of this work before.
We are.
We actually proposed a grant last year for the same identical project,
we
and
didn't
we
get
did
it?
Not get the funding.
Every year, the restoration research program that the Chesapeake Bay Trust puts out, they come out with 10 kind of scientific questions that they hope to answer. Last year, the thermal impact was not one of those questions. We submitted on a kind of another type of question, but wasn't really fall in line. This year, they reached out to us in actually in December at the annual conference and let us know that the thermal question was in the research proposal this year for us to answer.
Okay, that's why I guess it's familiar to me, because all this language and the things that you want to attempt here, I thought we had discussed last year. So, okay.
I'll move the Board of County Commissioners approve the submittal of the grant application acceptance of award to the Chesapeake Bay Trust Restoration Research Award Program.
Second.
So the county in-kind match, $8,500 for equipment?
Yes.
What does that consist of? I mean,
so essentially what we're looking at doing is be a controlled paired watershed study. So we'll be looking at traditional wet ponds that we currently implement in like use one streams that don't have the cold or cool water requirements, and then implementing one with a gravel lens in the bottom that helps interact with the groundwater to see if we can get more colder water out of these wet ponds that will allow us to implement these in these other types of streams themselves.
The equipment we have, most of the equipment is in stock, and if we don't, it's in our operating budget to purchase if we need it.
Yep.
What do you got, ESP or something?
Just responding to your question, sir.
How about staff time?
We've allocated for that as well. Byron and his staff are working. Actually, we're monitoring some of the facilities currently that we're going to be monitoring in the future. We've already kind of started this process because even if we don't get the grant funding, we feel that it's very important to do this study on our own because of the outcome of it could be very beneficial to the county.
Okay.
So we've already started a portion of it.
Okay. All right. Very good. Any other questions? All right. I've got a motion and second. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Okay. Request approval to exercise the option to purchase a farm in District 1, I believe, through the Critical Farms Program. And Deb and JP are both here. Good morning.
Good morning, Commissioners.
Good morning, Commissioners.
Good morning.
We have for you this morning one of our Critical Farms applicants. As you know, the Critical Farms Program is the program in which we help a farmer buy a farm. Very often it's a young farmer buying their first farm. Sometimes it's not. Sometimes they're buying their second farm, and that can be important too. As you know, it takes a lot of land to do well in farming. So this particular farm was approved by the advisory board back on December 12th, I believe, yes, and then it was given preliminary approval by you on December 20. We always settle these farms within 120 days. That's our promise from the beginning, and that enables these buyers to get a good contract and carry out what they say they're going to do. So this one is an excellent farm out on Frizzleburg Road. It is going to be purchased by Byron D. and Deborah Stamball and their son, Byron D. Stamball, Jr. It's in District 1. It's 82.4 acres, has 5 lot rights, and our purchase assistance, which, remember, is the lower of the contract price or the appraised fair market value. Okay, in this case, it was the appraised fair market value that was lower. So the purchase assistance will be $315,892, and that equals 52.5% of the appraised value.
And they will then apply to MALF?
Yes, the next step will be they apply to MALF for the easement. And when that occurs, we will get back our money that we have put into it. In other words, this is our part of the purchase. We are required to pay 40% of that easement value, and this will more than cover that. So we get that money back. The farm is located just northwest of Westminster, as you can see there. Here is an aerial view of the farm. It is almost entirely open, so it is available for a variety of uses in farming. It also is going to be joining some preserve farms on each side there, east and west, and in an area that is going to be available for farming in perpetuity. So it's a good place to be locating a new farm. Here are a couple photographs. This was being used for sheep, but I don't think Mr. Stambaugh is going to be using it for that. He, in all likelihood, will grow corn. It has great soils for corn, this property does. Class 2, and a type of soil that is good for growing corn in Carroll County. So we are coming today for a final approval on this critical farms purchase.
You have a question?
Where did Rattlesnake Branch get its name?
there's rattlesnakes.
That one scares me a little bit on that one. I just wonder.
Somebody might have had an unfortunate.
I was just.
I grew up right there on Rattlesnake Branch.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. So.
They named it after you.
Yeah. But I've seen a rattlesnake up there, too.
Have you?
Yeah.
Have you?
Okay. Now, I don't know whether that's how they got the name, but I've just. Yeah.
So. Most likely there were some rocks where there were some rattlesnakes.
Yeah. This is a good farm. Very familiar with it.
Yes.
And I think it's, you know, for the stand balls, I think it's a win-win.
It'll be great for corn production.
Yeah,
yes.
It really will. So, and I think this farm's been sitting empty a little bit, right? For a while, I think, if I remember correctly or not, JP. I can't.
Yeah,
I know
they've been wanting
there.
To sell it for a while.
It has been on sale. It has been for sale for a while. Yes.
Okay.
I'm sure those sheep have fertilized that soil well over the years.
After they ate up all the grass. Yeah.
Tim, over to you.
This is just the type of family we enjoy helping. The Stambaughs are a great agricultural family. They do a lot of custom work in the area, and they've bred a lot of nationally known dairy cattle at their farm. And their son is, you know, continuing that tradition along with his brother and their sisters. And it's a great addition to their agribusiness.
Okay.
I'll move the Board of Commissioners to exercise the Critical Farms Program option to purchase for the Byron D. Endeavor Stambaugh and Byron D. Stambaugh Jr. property at 2450 Frizzleburg Road in Westminster.
Second.
All right. Any other questions? All those in favor?
Aye.
Thank you, guys.
Thank you.
Yep, thank you.
Thank you, Commissioners.
Yep. Okay. Anything for open admin besides agendas? You got anything, Roberta?
I'd like to get it, not right now, but put on the agenda, get an update on what's happening with the rezoning of North Carroll. Is it moving forward? I mean, we put that in months ago. I haven't heard a thing about it.
Okay. Anything else? All right, let's roll with agendas. Hi, Vivian.
Hey.
How you doing?
Hey.
Oh. Okay.
Are the agendas that challenging today?
Yes.
Is that it?
Yes,
Jesus whiz. Okay.
It's the President's Day on Monday. We need to.
Oh, okay. So the coming week of February the 18th, reminder to everyone that county offices will be closed in observance of President's Day. That evening is the District 5 night in Annapolis. Commissioners Rothstein, Weaver, and Boucher will be attending. Tuesday the 19th, Planning and Zoning, Commissioner Rothstein at 9 a.m. 2 p.m. is the Veterans Advisory Meeting with Commissioner Weaver, and Silver Run Union Mills Advisory Group Meeting at Pleasant Valley Fire Company is at 7 p.m. that evening.
I'll probably attend the Veterans Advisory Meeting as well.
Okay. So. All right, at 7:30 a.m., and it's interesting because you were paying attention today, we heard a reference to golf superintendents and the fact that the FFA community supports that, and there have been folks that have come out of that to be superintendents. So anyway, on Wednesday the 20th, I'm speaking to the Mid-Atlantic Association of Golf Course Superintendents in Clarksville at 7:30 a.m. And the rest of the day is MACO. Commissioners Wance and Rothstein will be down there. And the Community College Board meeting is that evening at 6 p.m. with Commissioner Frazier. Thursday the 21st, open session, public hearing on a veterans shuttle. We've got a decision on the Water and Sewer Master Plan Triennial Update. Bid approval, mowing and tree shelter maintenance, mowing for stormwater facilities, and we'll have our legislative update from Mike Fowler. At noon is the Chamber County Budget Luncheon, starring Ted Zaleski. That's at the Best Western, and we all will be attending that at noon. Back in open session in the afternoon, request approval to proceed to public hearing for IR text amendment, and then we continue our work session on comprehensive rezoning. Nothing on Friday the 22nd. Saturday the 23rd, Carroll County 4-H Senior Ambassador interviews. Commissioner Weaver, Commissioner Frazier has the commissioner's report. Anything on that week? February the 25th, nothing on Monday. Tuesday, we have scheduled another comp rezoning work session. That might get changed. We'll see how we make out on the previous one. Wednesday the 22nd is MACO. And that afternoon is also the retirement celebration for Westminster Police Chief Spaulding. All of us are listed to be appearing there. I'm going to get with all of you guys so that we can hit that at the right time, because we've got a proclamation to give to him. So we'll have to try to get the timing down as to when we all get there.
Because I'm teaching on Wednesday.
Yeah, I know. So we'll work that out. 6 p.m., downtown Sykesville connection. Main Street presentation, Commissioner Rothstein in Sykesville, obviously. I don't know where else you'd have that.
Or at least hopefully.
Yeah. Hopefully, you know. Thursday the 28th, open session. Approval for transfer of funds for Freedom Park surfacing project. Resolution and declaration of intent to reimburse expenditures from our comptroller and economic development office renovation work with Public Works. And a state assistant for broadband feasibility study. And what else do we have that day? Open session in the afternoon. We'll get a budget update from Ted. And then we have infrastructure discussion, obviously, that goes along with that. So that's the afternoon. I don't think there's an LTAC meeting, so I think that can be removed. And for the record, we've got some information on that I'll be discussing with my colleagues as well moving forward about the direction of LTAC. We'll be discussing that. That evening is PM Connections, and it stars the VIP project, the Veterans Independent Project at the VFW.
I'll be attending.
Right. I think so. Yeah.
All right. Nothing on the first. Saturday the second is Celebrating America's History Expo at Winter's Mill. Wance, Rothstein, and Boucher will all be there.
Put my name down for that as well.
And Frazier. It's also Read Across America at the Town Mall.
Oh,
Weaver, Boucher, and Frazier will be at that one as well.
Do I get to read some Dr. Seuss?
Yep.
And take my name off the second one.
The Read Across America.
Right, because I won't be able to make that.
If you get there in time, you can eat green eggs and ham. That's always true. Been a highlight of the day.
Just don't look at it.
Right. National NACO's Resilient Counties Luncheon and Recognition Announcement. And I'm glad to see you're going to that, Commissioner Frazier, on Saturday the 2nd at noon. Actually, Carroll County is receiving the Soul Smart designation that day,
yeah.
We are one of only...
We're the only county in the state of Maryland
okay.
to receive that designation. The city of Laurel has also received it.
Okay. So...
I just want to shine some light on it. That's why I'm going.
Stop. Bino, keep going. Keep going.
Wow. B&O Railroad Historical Society Founders Day Dinner in Eldersburg. Commissioner Rothstein that evening at 6 p.m. And Commissioner Boucher has the commissioner's report. Anything else? Well, I'm not even going to ask. There's nothing else for the agendas.
Oh, wait. There was something for open admin.
Oh. Open admin?
Yes. We need last week you had a closed session regarding personnel. We need you to adopt a summary of the closed minutes for public review.
Okay.
Is
there a motion?
So a motion to adopt the minutes from the closed session from last week.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Okay.
I'm sorry, I almost forgot. Sitting to the side.
All right.
Tim, we'd be lost without you.
Okay. I now need a motion to go into closed for land acquisition.
So moved.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye. After that, I need a motion to adjourn.
Motion.
Sir. Motion to adjourn.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Thank you all very much. Have a safe weekend. And by the way, happy Valentine's Day again. Denise with the red, you know, you're sporting it. Nicely done.